Hello, this is Lisa Willis with the second episode of my podcast, which I'm now changing the title to 88 Keys, which would go along with the new chess club that Dummy and Judith Atari have started. And we're going to do some tournaments. In fact, we have a tournament tonight, and we're going to have one once a month. I'm going to do a podcast once a week. This is still really basic stuff, you know, but there is some high-tech cool stuff in the works, I promise. But right now I'm just going to play, sorry you can't see the whole keyboard, but I'm just going to play June 11th again. I have some other pieces written, but I have to have a copy written, and that costs money, and haven't copywritten yet. So I'm just going to play this. This is the latest version of June 11th, I'm always changing it. So this is my, and then I had to copyright that, you know. But so anyway, nobody cares, right? So I'm going to play June 11th, and then I'm going to do my commentary. Tonight's commentary is going to be on the Super Bowl and football in general. I'm not into football as much as I once was, but I kind of like it. It's kind of fun, and I don't have the passion that I had for it once since, so I can kind of enjoy it. And so, my team is the Cowboys, so obviously I have to talk about them. And of course, the Super Bowl. Okay, so I'm gonna play June 11th. Okay. I have to check the volume. Okay. Thank you. Okay. That is my newest creation of Judah Leppard. It's a living piece, and it's a story that I don't want to keep going into because I don't think it's proper. So the Super Bowl predicted just as I said. No, I'm kidding. That's if I'm looking at the score. So I don't follow football as much as I used to, but I used to follow it a lot, and I'm knowledgeable about the game. And quite frankly, I thought Philadelphia was going to win, but I thought it was kind of close, and I wasn't really that sure. And quite frankly, in the first half, it looked like I was right. But the reality is that Patrick Mahomes is just a hell of a quarterback. I'm really more into baseball now. I really am, but I like to watch it. And to be honest with you, I was a little inspired by that. But he had really bad ankle injury, pretty obvious pain. And then there's that one run towards the end of the game where he runs like, what, maybe 20, 30 yards. And I mean, it was obvious the pain he was in. That was very inspiring, I thought. So I liked it, you know. I thought it was really cool. I have to talk about my Dallas Cowboys. I rather dramatically divorced them last year on Facebook. I don't think anybody was paying attention, but nevertheless, I did do it. But then I took them back. Yeah. It's one of those, what do they call those relationships? I can't think of it. But it's toxic relationships. A toxic relationship. I should know. I've been in enough of them. It's a toxic relationship, you know. Without getting into it, I've been watching the Cowboys for a long, long time, okay? And longer than what it might look. And I'm telling you that this team, I'm pretty sure Skip Bayless wrote a book about this. I think he's persona non grata, if that's the right term now. I never did read up on that. It was something about some comment he made or some tweet he made or something. And I was busy, so I fucking didn't. So I don't actually know. So hopefully he has been banned and I'm not supposed to talk about it or something. I fucking don't know. Sorry. Well, I guess I should say that I'm on a mechanics institute. Isn't that cool? So I've been watching the Cowboys for a long time. And the problem with the Cowboys is the same. You can change the coach, you can change the quarterback or the receiver. You could even change the owner, and I don't know if it'd make that much difference. Look back at the history of this team. This history goes back before I was born, before I was paying attention, but I'm a bit of a historian here, okay? They played the Pittsburgh Steelers in the 70s twice. They were both close games. They lost one game 21-17. I can't remember the years, but they lost one game 21-17, the other one 35-31. I think it was the 35-31 one. I'm not sure about it because I only know it from when I was a kid on Saturday. I used to watch those NFL highlights. I used to fucking love those things. I love those fucking films, man. I'm sure it's on YouTube or something. I'll look that up. Those are really fun films, you know. And I like the game. I enjoy it. But anyway, I lost my train of thought. So I can't remember which one this was. It was either the 35-31 one or the 21-17 one. I think his name was Jackie Smith. And Roger Staubach throws him what would have been the winning touchdown, hits him right in the stomach, it goes to the ground, and they lose the game. You know, and people say, what rotten luck. Okay, well, how about the Super Bowl they won that decade? The second one against the Broncos, a really sloppy game, right? Both teams just did not play very well. Well, what happens if Denver decided to show up ready to fucking play? Maybe they win that game. You know? And so then, of course, we have to talk about all of the collapses. You know, the one that I was really paying attention to was in 1980. I'm dating myself a bit here. Who cares? Which one of my is going to know? There's no point in secrets. Secrets are pressure. I don't live my life with secrets. I am who I am, and you either like it or you don't. And I hope you like it, but you know, I can't live my life like that, because that's just too much pressure. You're putting yourself under pressure. And that, to me, that just doesn't make it. There's enough pressure in life as it is. We all feel it all the time, you know? And some of it you can't avoid, but don't put more on just to be doing it. You know? To me, that doesn't make any sense. Now, you know, look at me to talk. I know I've done that a lot of times myself, but just trying not to, at least. But anyway, I'm having like crazy person because of my meditation period, which I play better on. So, you know, open for commercials if anybody wants to do one. I actually think that's a pretty brilliant idea. I pitched that to a couple of dispensaries, and so far I have not heard anything. You know, I think it's a fantastic idea. I play better when I indulge I think I wrote this in an article once, because when I first moved, because I grew up in Pasadena, but I lived in Reno for like 14 years, and then I moved here in San Francisco. I moved, almost a year and a half ago. And so at first I've been kind of going back and forth from Reno to San Francisco, trying to take care of all kinds of stuff, because, you know, my mom had died recently and all kinds of stuff going on, you know. And so I'm getting on the Greyhound back and forth. And excuse me, I'm getting over a bit of a cold. So go on the Greyhound back and forth. And so this one driver is so cool. He does his speech, and they don't want you smoking marijuana during the trip, you know, because I guess what people do is like they wait for the best stop and they go off to the side somewhere and, you know, do their thing, you know, and they don't want you to do that, so they give you a speech at the beginning of each trip. And this guy had a very unique speech. He said something like, he said, please wait until the end of your trip before you indulge. I don't know, I always found that amusing. Because, of course, I had used edibles, so I was stoned. So actually, I found it funny. I don't know if they think they're fooling. But I can take an edible at home. It is legal, can I? So, of course, I don't get a Greyhound anymore anyway, so it doesn't matter. But I'm assuming I can eat a Greyhound, I can eat an apple at home, and then get in an Uber and go to a Greyhound, right? And get on the bus. I'm assuming that I haven't confessed anything I like. Hopefully not. I'm not getting any more Greyhound anyway, so it doesn't matter. After that, didn't they have some shooting with that thing or something a while ago? I don't know, I didn't want to get into all that stuff. Anyway, the Cowboys. So, I remember 1980 when I was expecting them to win, and Wilbur Montgomery just ran all over them. I think he had 231 yards, something, a lot. He had a ton of yards. I think it was 231. And then this one drives me nuts. I happen to be in San Francisco. I have a lot of friends here, and so I'm not trying to step on any toes. But 1981, okay, first of all, Joe Montana was throwing that ball away. Look at the replay. He was not hitting Dwight Clark at the, he was throwing the ball away. And if Tootall Jones had timed his jump properly, look at the video. And Tootall Jones jumped up at the wrong time, and then Joe Montana waited for him to come down, and then threw the ball. If Tootall Jones, which I think was like, what, 7 feet tall or something, I think. was just doing it or not. And then Dwight Clark just happened to be there and thought, okay, all right, okay. But maybe I'm wrong about all of that. And maybe it was just a spectacular play and I'm just a bitter Cowboy fan. Okay, look at the end of that play though, because there was about 30 seconds left and the Cowboys had a receiver open and then he went missed him. Look at the end of the play. Okay, so the Cowboys have been doing this type of thing to their fans for a really long time. Okay, how about 1983? I'll never forget 83 because this is during the time in my life when I was foolishly thinking about maybe I'll play professional football. So I was really enamored with them. And I remember they were playing the Rams and in the playoffs, and the Cowboys were they all ate breakfast together. And they had cameras in there. So this was during the pregame show. And we see them all in business suits, very quiet, very stoic, eating their breakfast. You know, business, serious business, you know. And then they go out there and get the shit beat out of them. Eric Dickerson just ran. Now, okay, so Eric Dickerson really ended up with like 15,000 yards. He's one of the greatest running backs of all time. But for fuck's sake, I mean, it looked like it was Little League. You know? What was all that nonsense? All that posing for the camera. The Rams weren't doing that, were they? They weren't posing for cameras, were they? And then, of course, they sucked in 84 and 85. There were no consequences. 87, but really, there were no consequences for quite some time until... I'm skipping over. I'm having a memory lapse. I'm skipping over 82, where really, Redskins are probably just better, and so, you know, I'm not gonna... I mean, that John Riggins, he was badass. I loved John Theismann. I'm sorry, Joe Theismann. So, they were just a better team in 82, you know. So, I think this was the funniest that I forgot about that year. So, you know. So anyway, fast forward to when they're relevant again. Now, I thought that in 91, they did pretty good. They were a very young team, and then they played Minnesota, I think, and lost. But they won again, playoff game that year, I can't remember. But they played well, and so I was proud of them. The next year, they were a very young team. They had to play the 49ers and San Francisco, and I must admit to you, I was a little nervous. You know, it's a young football team, and I remember thinking, you know, these guys are kind of young. I don't know if they can handle all this pressure playing in San Francisco, a playoff game, you know, but they fucking delivered, okay, and then, of course, you say, well, what are you complaining about? Okay, so yes, they did win the Super Bowl by a very large margin against the Buffalo Bills, 52-17. I say 52-17. Why am I emphasizing that? Who knows why I'm emphasizing the number 52? Because it should have been 59. Okay? Excuse me, Mr. Leon Lett, Mr. Showboat, the same guy that cost us a game the next year in the snow against Miami. You know, with his nonsense. Okay? Even in our blowout win, we have this asterisk. And I think that would have broken a record or something, or maybe later somebody scored. I think I'm not sure about this, but I think the 49ers scored 55 in 94, I think, and they beat the Cowboys record, which they wouldn't have done if it had been 59 points. I think it was something like that. Okay, that's petty. They won the Super Bowl by a large margin, and I should be happy. But even in victory, you can see what happens. Okay, and then the next year, they kind of went to sleep in the first half, and we're losing 13-7. Then they come alive in the second half, they win 38-13. Okay, all right, wonderful. How about the next year? By the way, who fires their coach after they win two straight Super Bowls? does that? I mean, I'm sorry, I know that was a long time ago, but somebody wanted to explain that one to me. Jimmy Johnson wins back-to-back Super Bowls and it's fired. I'm still waiting for an explanation on that one. So Barry Switzer comes in. No offense against Barry Switzer, but they clearly were not prepared to play against the 49ers. They show up asleep, hungover, whatever the hell, and next thing you know, they're down 28-10. But then they outscored the 49ers after that. Look at the game. They outscored the 49ers by, I think, 10 points the rest of that game. They were better. They had beaten the 49ers twice. They were better. But they threw that game away. Then the next year, in 95, I can't remember the quarterback of Pittsburgh, but he doesn't throw that late interception, and maybe they don't win that game. You know, I've been watching this team snatch defeat out of the jaws of victory for a long time. And I think that I didn't actually read the book, so, and like I say, I don't know if he's like, off limits now or something, because I obviously do not have the time to be worried about what tweet some dude put. I have no clue as to what he has something to do with that guy that collapsed. I didn't even follow that story. I just found out the other day that he had cardiac arrest, because I was just really busy with a bunch of stuff and I just didn't get a chance to follow any news. So it wasn't like I didn't care, I just didn't have the time. But anyway, I'm rambling on like crazy. Why am I talking about that? Anyway. The point is, skip it. Okay. So he wrote this book. I didn't read it, so I don't know if it's pure trash or it's a Pulitzer Prize or something in between. But it's my understanding, at least based upon something that he said or something, it's my understanding that the basic theory is that in Dallas, you have football is like massively popular in Texas. I mean, that's to put it mildly, you know, and the most popular football team in that entire state is the Dallas Cowboys. So if you are a member of the Dallas Cowboys and you're going to the grocery store with your wife or you're going to the restaurant or you're going to the local coffee shop or you're taking your kids to school or whatever, and you're constantly running into fans that are telling you, oh, you're going to kick the 49ers butts on Sunday. Oh, I can't wait for that. Oh, you guys are the best. I mean, wow. All week long. And they start to believe it. And the other team is not doing that. The other team is focused. The other team is afraid. You know, they may not want to admit it. But for somebody that's competed, I'm certainly not competing in the level of the Super Bowl, but I have competed a little bit. And you know, I've played in some chess tournaments, and I've played in the U.S. Open Championship in 2003, I'm really dating myself. I've played games where it's a very interesting position, and maybe there's 10 people watching it, and you're a little nervous because you know that if, you know, everybody's watching the game, right? And so if you make some ridiculous move and then lose, everybody's gonna say, oh my gosh, she's an idiot. How could she not have seen blah, 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 you know? So there's a certain amount of pressure. And when you're performing, quite frankly, you know, you don't want to fuck up. You don't want to mess up. So you're trying to. So there's a certain amount of pressure, okay? You know, I think that's needed. That fear, that fear that you might not win, that you might not play that piece perfectly, that you might not win that chess game. And it's that fear. I practice like crazy. I practice until my fingers are tired or sore. You know? Because I want to make sure that I don't make any mistakes. And so there's got to be a certain level of fear, I think, in order for you to become a champion. Because otherwise you become complacent. How many times have we seen teams that really were the better team, but just couldn't get it done? And it's because of that. It's because of a lack of fear, really, of losing, you know? And I think that's what the Cowboys' problem is. And, listen, this is tough love, but, I tried to stop following that team. I really did, because they were just annoying me so much, and they still do. But, and again, I'm really more into baseball, so, but when I'm into football, I wouldn't mind if they won a Super Bowl. But, the way they're playing and the way they've been playing for quite some time, and it doesn't seem like it's going to change, because I don't think that they realize, if I'm right, I don't think they realize it, that's what their problem is. And so they're gonna, I'm not, again, I'm totally not following it, so I don't know if they've made some move or whatever. But, they'll do something or other. They'll fire their head coach, or they'll trade their quarterback, or they'll get a new receiver, or they'll change defensive coordinator, do some nonsense, and none of it will matter. And next year, they'll be good, and the commentators will all get on television and say, oh, they're gonna be good this year. And idiots like me will believe it, and then the playoffs will come along, and it will be the same thing. So, anyway, so like I know what the hell I'm talking about football, but I did have sort of an interest in the game. It was a very good game for sure, and like I say, incredibly inspired by Patrick Mahomes. Really, I hate, it sounds so cliche to say, but really gutty performance, in grimacing in pain and running down the field. It had to have been at least 30 yards, 20, 30 yards or something. Crucial moment in the game, So that was really something. So it was, and I wasn't really, really for the team, because, like I said, I'm a Cowboy fan, and my team was terrible. So, and even though I guess I'm supposed to dislike the Eagles, I always kind of liked that team, and I was trying to figure out why. First of all, I liked the old team too. Like, I was talking about Willis Montgomery, but I liked Willis Montgomery and Ron Jaworski, and I like those guys. I like those old Eagles. I always liked those teams, even though I was a Cowboy fan. I just liked them, And their uniforms are nice. I like, I mean, it's silly, but I think they're pretty colors. They're green. I like it. I like their colors. They have the really cool, wing thing with a jig or something. I like that. But what sealed it for me was that Mark Wahlberg movie. I think it was called Invincible, I think. And I don't know if you've seen that, but that's about a guy. He's a bartender, and he ends up trying out for the team. It's really cool. So I like that team, in other words. But I wasn't really, I like the Kansas City Chiefs too. Hank Stram, keep articulating the ball down the field or whatever he said. So I liked both teams. I wasn't really for either one. Anyway, my second episode, I promise more bells and whistles in the future. I'll talk to you later. Lisa Willis, see you later. Bye.